that come true. I'm glad that we are different. We've better things to do. May others plan their future. I'm busy loving you.
Hello and welcome to another episode of Strike Fighters 2 Vietnam as we follow the career of Lieutenant Commander Devin Horner as he flies A-6 intruders off the USS Enterprise in support of Operation Rolling Thunder. To begin with, today you may have noticed that I have installed some new content. I acquired two big items. The first was the Yankee Air Pirate USS Enterprise, which is a payware model. And I think it's a big improvement from the Strike Fighters 1 free Enterprise that I was using previously. Now, the ship still is technically, historically inaccurate for this time period. The model comes with the post-1979 superstructure and radar setup, but I'm okay with that. I have yet to find any Enterprises for this game that have the original Beehive superstructure, and this model is already a huge improvement over the previous one I was using. So I'm quite happy with it, and really this is how the Enterprise looked when I was on it, so it's very familiar to me in this configuration, so I'm okay with it. I think it is still representing the ship very well. The second item is that I downloaded the mod Green Hell 3.5. Now, this was recommended to me from a user called MagnumFR. He sent me a link for this updated Green Hell. I had been previously using one of the earlier versions that had come with the Vietnam expansion that I run here, and somebody had come along much later and done a much better version that we're going to be seeing from here on out. So merci beaucoup to MagnumFR. Thanks for sending that along. We're going to see a much improved ground texture here for the rest of the campaigns. Okay, with that business over, let's take a look at today's mission. It's February 21st, 1967. Our mission today is going to be to strike a strategic target located in the Hanoi Thermal Power Plant. We are to destroy the enemy generator building in the target area. This is going to be a fun one. This is right downtown in Hanoi, right next to the Red River, so not going to be a cakewalk today. Call sign is Ramrod. We'll be flying two A6 intruders, takeoff time of 9:55, and should be returning at 10:45. Now let's take a look at our loadout for these aircraft. You can see that we're back in aircraft 300 yet again, and after the calamity of last mission with my inability to use the laser-guided bombs properly, you can see today I have loaded four AGM-62 Walleyes on board and a single 2,000-pound freefall bomb just as a backup, but I'm going to try to use the lessons from last mission and actually hit the target with those laser-guided bombs. And if I don't, then we've got the one-ton bomb as a backup. Ramrod 2, as an additional backup, will be loaded with 26 Mark 82 Snake Eyes, which are the 500-pound bombs with the retarding fins on the back for low-level deployment. Checking out the map for today. Okay, here we are. We'll be departing from Yankee Station here, proceeding north up to Waypoint 3. Then we'll be heading inland at an altitude of 5,900 feet. We'll be over the target about 18 minutes in. We'll drop our bombs in Hanoi and get that power plant. And you can see that here's a MiG-21 F-13 squadron right here at Phu Kien. We've really been taking a toll on the enemy aircraft because there's only one other fighter squadron. It's these J-5s over at Yen Bai. So that'll be nice. The enemy fighter presence will be pretty low today. Only two fighter squadrons. Okay, additional squadrons heading in today. We have an Iron Hand flight of Skyhawks off the Ranger. Dagger flight is for F-8 Crusaders. They're on escort duty heading up to Phu Kien, which will be right in our area as well, so that they'll be nearby. Showtime flight is for A-4 Skyhawks off of the Enterprise. They'll be launching along with us. They're striking the Guy Lam Machine Tools facility, which I believe is also in or around Hanoi. So that'll be four flights heading in from the ocean today, plus whatever the Air Force is sending from the west. And now, looking at the roster for today, I am leading the flight, as usual, as Ramrod 1, and my wingman is none other than Lieutenant Commander Mike McDonald. That's right, Michael McDonald, famous musician. He come from somewhere, back in the long ago. So he'll be along with us, providing entertainment along the way into downtown. All right, that concludes today's briefing. Let's get ready to launch these A6 intruders, and we'll see you up on the flight deck for another mission into downtown Hanoi. Taking our position up on Catapult 1, getting ready for launch, we get a nice close look at the Yankee Air Pirates USS Enterprise. We see Skittles all over the flight deck doing their various jobs. We can see tow equipment in the background. There's a P-25 firefighting vehicle, which is the red and white vehicle parked there between the two catapults. That's where the crash and salvage crews hang out during launch and recovery operations, ready to assist in any sort of flight deck emergency. And now we can actually see the shooter. And he's given us a sign. Oh, there goes Ramrod 2, Lieutenant Commander McDonald. Ramrod 1 is airborne. Sucking up the gear, we'll make our clearing right turn and climb up to 500 feet, and we'll hold altitude here as we proceed 7 miles away from the ship. We can see the ocean is a nice kind of sea green color now. Definitely more green with this new texture pack than previously. It was more of a dark blue. I can't speak to what the actual Gulf of Tonkin looks like color-wise, but I do know that the ocean definitely has a distinct change in color as you get further away from shore. When we would leave port, it would be sort of a sea green color, similar to this, I think. But then once you get out into the actual deep ocean, it turns this extremely dark blue. It's a very noticeable difference. So, Gulf of Tonkin, probably not that deep, so this may be appropriate, but like I said, I can't speak from experience either way. So that's just the color it is now, and we just have to deal with it. All right, turning to my my waypoints, getting set up here. We're going to go up to 5,900 feet to make our way into Vietnam and into Hanoi. Now that I've switched to the Yankee Air Pirate Enterprise, we have seen that it's still not historically accurate for the Vietnam time frame. The radars and weapons are in its post-1979 overhaul configuration. But it would still be interesting to talk about that nest of antennas up top and find out exactly what they do. It just so happens that I still have a study guide from the ship that describes all the radar, so let's now take a look at the superstructure of the Enterprise. When the ship was commissioned in 1961, she was equipped with what is known as the Beehive superstructure. The Beehive was a thimble-shaped structure on top of the island, which housed the ship's electronic countermeasure equipment. The distinctive square superstructure, unique among carriers, was due to the placement of the Navy's first phased array radar, called SCANFAR. A phased array radar doesn't physically rotate like a conventional one, but instead uses flat panels containing an array of small antennas. Different currents are sent to each antenna, and the net result is that the direction of the radar beam can be turned electronically. The SCANFAR system consisted of two radar panels, the AN-SPS-32 and the AN-SPS-33. Together, these two radars would give a three-dimensional picture of targets. In this case, relating to radars, the three dimensions are range, bearing, and altitude. Two panels were placed on all four sides of the superstructure for 360-degree coverage. The same system was also installed on the nuclear cruiser USS Long Beach. SCANFAR, built by the Hughes Corporation, had a surface range of 400 nautical miles and an air range of 200 nautical miles. The system was based on vacuum tubes, and reliability was always a problem. The vacuum tubes constantly broke and had to be replaced, leaving the system down on a regular basis. In 1967, the tubes were replaced by solid-state electronics, which lightened the superstructure by 20 tons. However, SCANFAR was still unreliable and expensive, and the technology to properly aim the radar beams was not perfected yet. Considered a failure, SCANFAR was removed from the Enterprise in 1979 and from Long Beach in 1985. Despite its failure, SCANFAR provided important experience for finally developing effective phased array radars, which are now standard in many military and civilian uses. After 1979, the SCANFAR radar systems were replaced with the standard rotating radars that we see here, and the ship would use those for the rest of its life. Let's take a close look at them now. Starting at the top of the radio mast is the TACAN, the Tactical Air Navigation System. It provides aircraft with bearing and distance to the ship, and is three times more accurate than a standard VOR/DME in use in civilian aviation. The TACAN has a range of 390 nautical miles. On the first crossbar down is the Mark 23 TAS, or Target Acquisition System. This radar has a detection range of 110 nautical miles, with a tracking range of 50 nautical miles. This radar is part of the automatic defense system of the ship and is tied in to provide targets to the RIM-7 launchers and the SeaWiz system. Below that is the WRL-1H radar detector. This is a general-purpose, wideband signal receiver for detecting radio traffic or enemy radar sets targeting the ship. Below, on the next crossbar, is the ANSPS-64 primary navigation radar. This is used for detecting land masses and has a range of 30 miles. It can also be used as the backup radar for detecting surface targets. Next is the ANSPS-67 primary surface search radar. With a range of 64 nautical miles, this is the main radar for detecting surface targets. Next down on the mast is a crossbar facing aft, which holds the SBN-43 air traffic control radar. This is the air surveillance radar that the Carrier Air Traffic Control Center, known as CATC, uses to vector aircraft onto final approach and control aircraft within the carrier's airspace. Max range is 60 nautical miles up to 30,000 feet, with IFF, which is identification friend or foe, usable up to 240 miles. CATC controls aircraft within 50 miles of the carrier, in an airspace bubble known as the Carrier Control Area. Controllers hand off aircraft to PryFly, or Primary Flight Control. PryFly controls the Carrier Control Zone, which is 5 miles from the ship up to 2,500 feet. PryFly directs aircraft to a spot 1/4 mile from touchdown, where control is turned over to the LSOs and pilots call the ball. The large radar on the forward part of the superstructure is the ANSPS-48 Medium Air Search Radar. This is a three-dimensional radar with a range of 220 nautical miles. It reports range, bearing, and altitude. The aft radar antenna is the ANSPS-49 Long Range Air Search Radar. This is a two-dimensional radar, only reporting bearing and distance. Range is 250 nautical miles. The small radomes on the front of the superstructure are the Mark 95 fire control directors of the Sea Sparrow system. The aft radome is the EHF SATCOM link. Extremely high frequency communications with satellite recover faster than lower frequency radios in the event of an atmosphere nuclear detonation, meaning that the ship can regain communications in the event of an electromagnetic pulse. Mounted on the rear of the superstructure is the SPN-46 landing radar. This provides aircraft with course and glide path information. It also links up with aircraft computers to guide hands-free approach to touchdown. Known as Mode 1 approach, the autopilot can actually fly the plane all the way to touchdown. While there are a couple of other additional radars and antennas that I didn't cover, this is a pretty comprehensive list of the most important ones that we can see on the island. This bubble on the side of the island is the camera room. It's a small room that houses the television team and many different cameras that record flight deck operations. This is located on deck 07, or 7 decks above the hangar bay. 2 decks up from that, on the 09 level, is the flag bridge. This is the office of the admiral in charge of the fleet. He and his staff work out of this space, receiving reports and issuing orders. This is the center of all operations for the entire fleet. During workups or short cruises, when there's no admiral aboard, this space is empty. Also on the 09 level, just aft of the flag bridge, is Vulture's Row. This was the weather deck open to any ship's crew who were welcome to come up and watch flight ops. I used to jokingly call this my office, since I was up there almost every day. I would walk up the 11 flights of steps after standing watch in the plant. But it was nice to get some sun, or even just enjoy the bad weather if it was raining. I got to decompress by watching airplanes and the flight deck crew. It was also a nice retreat because I knew that only a handful of people knew where I was, just in case someone was trying to find me to make me do some sort of useless work. getting pegged to do some dirty work or relieve someone else on watch was referred to as getting stabbed. I knew that no one in the plants would be inclined to climb up those 11 flights of stairs just to get me, so it was a safe place for me to hide from being stabbed for useless work. Next, on the O10 level, is the navigation bridge. This is where the captain commands the ship from. Helmsmen steer, the lee helmsman rings up the bells for the propulsion plants, quartermasters work on navigating, the bosun's mate of the watch coordinates reports from all the lookouts, and the OOD, or officer of the deck, supervises all ship's operations, reporting directly to the captain. The ship's bell is located here, and all 1MC announcements are made from the bridge. The captain's seat is in the front left corner. Above the bridge, on the O11 level, is PryFly, or Primary Flight Control. This would be considered the control tower of the ship. From here, the air boss and his assistant, the mini boss, observe and direct the flight deck and air operations within 5 miles of the ship. Some of the ship's lookouts were stationed on this level, with the rest up on the top level at the base of the masts. Sometimes the O11 was also referred to by some people as Vulture's Row, but this was a more restricted area, and if you weren't from a squadron, you were likely to be asked to leave. If you were able to get up there, though, the view was unparalleled, and you had full view of the bow catapults, something that I could never see from my usual Vulture's Row on the O9. Also buried within the bowels of the island are other important spaces, such as flight deck control, the room with the famous Ouija board for controlling the movement of aircraft on the flight deck. This room is located on the O4 level. The CDC, or Combat Direction Center, is in the island as well. This is the brain for not only the ship, but for the fleet, providing information from satellite links, from land, other ships, and aircraft. All available information is funneled here to be sorted, and the captain or admiral can gain situational awareness at a glance. Orders can then be issued as necessary. So, in summary, the ship can detect surface targets at 64 miles. She can detect air targets at 250 miles, determine their IFF at 240, and detect their altitude at 220 miles. The targeting radar detects at 110 miles, then starts automatically tracking at 50, ready to fire Sea Sparrows or Sea Whiz accordingly. Air traffic control radar was 60 miles, and the navigation radar was 30 miles, detecting land masses or surface targets. All these systems work together to paint a detailed picture of the world around the ship and battle fleet, and also provide the all-important air traffic control needed to guide planes to and from the ship in an orderly manner.
Point.
I've dropped us down to 300 feet above the waves. We're skimming the waters on the way in to Vietnam this time. I want to make landfall just as fast as possible, max throttle. Just keep that speed up to avoid any sort of ground fire, AAA ground fire. And this will also keep us nice and low below the SAMs. There's Ramrod 2, just bristling with those snake eyes. It's 26 500-pound bombs.
Red Crown, Tampa lead, passing waypoint 4.
Tampa 1, Red Crown, copy.
We can see the coastline of Vietnam coming up to meet us very quickly here. Doing 400 knots, 300 feet. There's Haiphong off to our right. And coming over the beach just now, Ramrod 1 is feet dry. We get our first good look at the green hell 3.5 high resolution textures. An airbase right there over to our right, which includes some search radars, but from the sounds of things, nobody's picked us up yet, most likely due to our extremely low altitude. Let's see where our nearest bandits are. Oh, super far away. More than 50 miles out, so no immediate danger yet if that's the closest thing that we've got. You can see that circle of dots on the radar there. That's probably a SA-2 SAM site, I would guess. Let's see if we can see any missiles sticking up out of the trees. I do not at the moment, but talked about that before. The SA-2 system has the fire control radar in the center, and then a ring of usually six missiles surrounding it. So it has kind of a distinctive shape. Good to avoid. Although this low, we are, even if they could pick us up, we are well below the minimum altitude that an SA-2 could hit us, because even the advanced models had a minimum of 820 feet. So below 800 feet, even those SA-2Cs or later can't hit us. Alright, friendlies are starting to take fire now, as we're 3 miles out from the initial point. Pretty quiet for us so far. I think we're just sneaking up on people before they can even shoot at us. One mile to go. We can see the Red River on the radar coming up. There we go, we hit waypoint 4. That's our initial point. 15 miles away from the city. And we can see a bunch of ground unit dots there on the radar that we're just not going to be able to avoid. So things will start to get interesting as gunners wake up and start to realize that we are on our way in. There's the Red River coming up on us real fast. We can see it stretching off. It goes up to the north. After it flows Hanoi, it comes down this way. We'll flow to our left, past the city of Nam Dinh, before it goes out the Red River Delta and into the Gulf of Tonkin. We can see the new textures kind of make it look definitely more of like a muddy jungle river than the clear river waters of before. So that's an interesting difference. Right there is the... I can see the city limits coming up on us. Okay, full throttle. Ramrod 2, attack my target. And I'm gonna start... Whoa, taking fire from the right. Pink tracers going by. That was very close. Selecting my Walleyes as I'm going to climb up to altitude. Now it looked like Ramrod 2 is going to stay low with those snake eyes of his, make a low-level strike. I'm going to pop up to make sure that I have plenty of altitude to clear the explosion when I drop these Walleyes.
Ramrod, lead. Red ground. Bandit. Left 10 o'clock.
Whoa, one mile. There we go. That's a MiG-21 cruising by with two different SAM trails. Hopefully he doesn't notice us. My TV camera is locked right on this power plant. And we're just starting to get the tracking radar on us. Flak starting to come up. Of course, Flak also receiving the benefit of tracking radar, helping to direct it. Now, I don't want to release these bombs too early because they still have to glide down to the target since they're not powered. I don't want them to fall short, so. But I also don't want to wait too long because then we get what happened last time, so. Another SAM going by off in the distance there, off the 11 o'clock. 2 miles from the target. And I'm going to start nosing over. And I think it's time to drop. Bombs away. There they go. Got to keep the nose down a little bit. Want to make sure that the TV camera, the laser designator, doesn't lose the target. Here's the first walleye on its way in. Looks like it's tracking good. Fire coming in from the 12 o'clock. Looks like the 57mm of an S60. Pulling up. Direct hit! Looked like all four missiles right into that power plant. Look at that. Wonderful. Okay, Ramrod 2. Start taking out some of these air defenses since you've got all your bombs left. Let's make use. We have a lot of guns around here, and he still has 26 bombs left, so I want him to make use of those. There's that S60. We still have a 2,000-pound bomb, so let's put him out of commission. Since we're here anyways. Flak coming up at us now. McDonald is dropping his bombs somewhere, I'm not sure. Keeping an eye out for those. There they are. Well done. Red Crown, Rambler leads. Passing 345. Rambler 1, Red Crown. Copy that. 57mm. Trying to reach out and touch me here. Don't want to get too close. Let's try to get the Pipper right over him. This is a big bomb, so we don't actually have to be too precise. Bombs away! Just barely missing. Whoa, those tracer rounds right by the wings. Right under the belly of the aircraft. Oh, this is going to be a direct hit with that 2,000-pound bomb. Boom! That is the end of that guy. Alright, I'm out of munitions, so let's wing over, let's get back down on the deck. You can see I'm only just under 4,000 feet, and there's flak all around me, and tracers coming in from all directions. Look at that! Just tracers everywhere, so many guns over there to my left. And a radar, or radio antenna, rather. Knife edge! Right by the antenna. Luckily not getting caught in any of the wires. Smoking remains of the power plant over there, downtown. Let's see if we can get Ramrod 2 to get back with me. More smoke coming up from the anti-air units that we blew up. Gray smoke off in the distance. Here is McDonald. He is in the thick of it. We have all sorts of things going on here. Look, there's an AN-12 Cub up there. Looks like it just took off from this airbase. He's trying to fly out of the area. There goes a SAM zooming by. There's two F-8 Crusaders in the background. Three, there comes a third Crusader. Looks like he's trying to attack this AN-12. And the AN-12 has a rear gun that's firing. Crusader zooming by. There's another Crusader coming in off to the back left there. Crazy, lots of activity. There's so much anti-air in the air, I'm surprised that AN-12 isn't being hit by mistake. Small town under the wing. Another SAM streak behind Ramrod 2 as he's making his way around Hanoi, heading to the south. You can see that he is still loaded with a ton of bombs. Even though he dropped a lot on that one AA gun, he's still got a lot more to go. So maybe on our way out, if we can find a spot that's not too dangerous, we could do some additional damage. I'll order him to attack maybe some ground units. No point in wasting that ordnance, right?
Sam lost. He's burning and going down. Sam lost. Direct hit.
Red crown. Archer lead.
Flying around these little hills here, below treetop level. Alright, making my turn to egress out towards the ocean now. We're gonna follow the terrain, go up over this little hill. We're 53 miles away from the next waypoint. So there's still a long way to go before we're safe. Up over this little guy. Radar altimeter showing 200 feet above the ground. I'm just coming even with those trees at the top of the hill. There's another little village / town. That's an improvement with the new green hell textures, the way that the little villages are reorganized. The bridge out to our right has been knocked down. You can see half of it floating in the river, a very brown river. All right, dead ahead. It looks like we have. Looks like we have another SAM site. This might be the perfect target of opportunity for our buddy Michael McDonald. There we go, it's an SA-2B SAM launcher. Let's see if I can find the fire... Oh, there we go, Fansong B radar. Hey, Ramrod 2, please take out this radar. This will be great for the war effort. This'll save us some grief. Oh, just right there behind the tail, we can see that fire control radar on the little truck. So I'm just going to fly interference in the area to maybe keep them busy, give them something to look at. And there we go. Yep, he's on me now. And hopefully distract them from Ramrod 2, who will be coming in very soon.
Sam lost.
lots of anti-air guns around as well. There's the fan song radar right down here in this field. Coming in right over the top of it now. Nothing firing at me yet, but of course we're so close to the site that the missiles wouldn't be able to track once they fired, so we're actually in a pretty safe eye of the storm zone. Here's Ramrod 2. Looks like he's just coming down past Nam Din. Yep, that's Nam Din off to our 1 o'clock. That's the Red River Delta. There we go. There he's coming down, taking some fire. 57 mils coming up from at least 3 locations, I think. Maybe 4. So I'm going to meet up with him, let's wing over, I'm going to get on his wing and ride it in as he makes his run on the target. Give the gunner something else to shoot at, a little bit of a distraction, I think. Up and over, tracking him through the haze of the blackout as I'm pulling some pretty hard G's. Right, we're close. He should be dropping any moment now. Let's see if we can see them drop off the plane. Tracer's coming in from 10 o'clock-ish over there. There they go. There they go, dropping right down. Just under my wing now. McDonald's pulling away. I'm pulling away. Let's see if it impacts. There they are. Nope. No, definite miss. Whoa, Sam coming up from right underneath us. Heading out towards who knows what. Okay, McDonald's still loaded with bombs, so let's get him back on this fan song. Yeah, please come back and come get it. It's actively firing at friends, so we need to put this thing out of commission right now. Oh, and McDonald taking some serious damage on his left wing. Missing some slats. The left air brake is gone. And now they're tracking me. Again, like I said before, this fan song is not only directing missiles up at friendlies, but it's also providing guidance information for those AA guns. There goes another Sam. Good, Ramrod 2 firing the last of his bombs. Oh, we see the second stage smoke of that Sam going off into the distance, accelerating it up to Mach 3.5. There's the fan song in the middle of that little tan field there. Let's hope those snake eyes hit from McDonald. Come on, no whammies, no whammies, no whammies, no whammies. Where are they? What are they, falling from space? Come on. What? You were a mile away. Oh my god. Okay, well, thanks for nothing on that one. So now we gotta get the hell out of here and not get shot, since the radar is still active. There we go, SAM launch! Jesus. Okay. exactly what I was trying to avoid. Wanted to just blow up that radar so it wouldn't be able to direct anything, but that was not to be, so time to egress back out to the ocean at treetop level. Let's just get out of here. Nam Din off to my left. Let's remind McDonald to rejoin, since we know that they chase butterflies a lot sometimes, so we'll just tell him a second time. Radar showing no contacts in front of us. Lots of shipping here, going in and out of the city. Cargo ships and shipping, of course, not being harassed by the U.S. at this time. No blockade. Among other countries' ships, Soviet ships all the time making deliveries full of aircraft, missiles, ammunition, everything to sustain their war effort, and we are not allowed to interdict any of that on the way in. So, one of the many frustrations of the Vietnam War. What are you doing, McDonald? Oh, God, he's not responding. He's been damaged to the point where he's just going to climb up and away from the area. And I don't have radio comms with him anymore, so he's on his own now. We see extensive damage on the tail as well. Nothing I can do about that. He is on his own. Hopefully he'll make it back to the ship in one piece. Since we talked about Airedale stuff on the way out to the target, let's move back down into the bowels of the ship on the way back in. The propulsion plant watch structure was sort of complicated on the Enterprise compared to the Nimitz class. It didn't seem too bad to me, but that's because that's all I knew. Coming up through training, I had heard Nimitz class sailors telling stories of visiting Enterprise and being confused by the complexity of it all. First of all, unlike the other nuclear-powered ships who only have a reactor department for nuclear-trained personnel, we had both a reactor and engineering department working in the propulsion plants. Our reactor department was in charge of our reactor operators, reactor mechanics, and reactor electricians. Engineering department, meanwhile, had responsibility for our E-Div electricians and steam plant mechanics, like me. M-Div was a mixed bag as well, split into both nuclear-trained mechanics and conventional mechanics. The conventionals worked in the AMRs, or auxiliary machinery rooms, operating the distillers and other auxiliary systems. They were not allowed to stand watch in the actual propulsion plants since they didn't have security clearances. Us nuke machinist mates, on the other hand, did have that clearance and could therefore stand watch in both main machinery rooms and aux machinery rooms. To complicate things further, engineering department as a whole also incorporated more than just the propulsion plants. It also included the damage control division, since the chief engineer's responsibilities include damage control for the whole ship. This didn't work out well for DC division when engineering and reactor departments were moved aboard for fast cruises as a punishment. A fast cruise is when the ship is in port, tied up, but you have to live aboard and have working hours like you're out to sea. It's basically the worst, especially because we were being punished for issues that the shipyard was having. Unfortunately, DC Div got pulled into this as well and had to come aboard even though they had nothing to do. We were pissed, but they were outraged, and it was completely understandable as they weren't even remotely connected with the issues that the ship was having. A Division was also part of engineering, and again was a part of our department that we hardly interacted with and often forgot that they were under the chief engineer's control. A Gang was staffed by non-nuclear machinist mates who didn't stand AMR watches. Instead, A Gang was in charge of running and repairing air conditioners, elevators, heating steam and pot water connections, washing machines, and more throughout the entire ship. The only mechanical systems outside their responsibility were the propulsion plants and the catapults and arresting gear. Getting into the propulsion watch teams themselves, it all started in central control, a large room located in the middle of the propulsion plants. Here sat the engineering officer of the watch. The Eow supervised the operation of all plants and damage control, as well as electrical distribution for the whole ship. The Eow was always in close contact with the OOD on the bridge to coordinate the ship's propulsion and steam needs. The Eow's assistant was the engineering chief of the watch, usually a chief petty officer who had intimate knowledge of the engine rooms and supervised the water control watch along with the AMRs. Water control was in charge of tracking hourly the total fresh water on board, the wastewater in the sewage tanks, and moving that water around to help trim the ship if necessary. The engineering officer of the watch gave orders to the four propulsion plant watch officers. A PPWO was in charge of all activities in his or her plant, and were the officers that we interacted with on watch. Propulsion plant watch officers manned their watch in the enclosed operating space. EOS was a small control room on the third deck of each plant. Enlisted watch stations in the space were the throttleman, two reactor operators, one for A and B reactors, and a phone talker. The propulsion plant watch supervisor was a roving watch that assisted the watch officer. The watch officer could not leave EOS, so the watch soup was in charge of face-to-face supervision of evolutions in the plant. Several other watchstanders around the plant were the reactor technician, feed control, several roving electricians, and I think a roving reactor mechanic watch. In the steam plant, the engine room was under direct control of the chief mechanical operator. The CMO was our senior in rate qualification. I was qualified CMO, but luckily didn't have to stand it too much. The CMO was in charge of all the engine room watchstanders and often gave technical advice to the watch officer and watch supervisor. Directly under the CMO was the engine room upper level watch, who was in charge of the equipment in engine room upper level. This included the ship service turbine generators, air compressors, the de-erding feed tank, the reduction gears, and main engines. Upper level controlled the air ejectors, the set of four Venturi tubes that drew a vacuum on the main condenser. There was a secondary throttle control in upper level for emergency local control of the engines. The feedwater booster pumps were tucked away in a corner directly underneath the de-erding feed tank. This is the area I've talked about several times and was the hottest place in the entire engine room. The booster flats consistently reached 145 degrees Fahrenheit and was a place to be avoided for any period of time. Moving downstairs, engine room lower level was technically a less senior watch station, but lower level was far more complicated than upper level with many more systems to keep track of. I stood engine room lower level for all of the 7 months of the O4 deployment. Lower level responsibilities included the main condensate system and its pumps, the lube oil system, the bilge, regulating condenser water levels, and checking pot water tank levels. The main circulation pump was a giant steam-driven seawater pump that had to be started when the ship's speed was low. Above a head one-third, the speed of the ship was sufficient to scoop up enough seawater to run through the main condenser to cool it, but when a head one-third or below was called, one of lower level's jobs was to open the big steam valve and start the pump. After that, we had to check that the 4-foot-wide flapper valves shut properly in the scoop induction because they occasionally got stuck. One of the daily tasks on board the ship at sea was to perform the daily midnight maintenance. This was done on the 10-2 watch, and lower level had the most maintenance to do out of anybody. The main lube oil strainers had to be shifted, cleaned, and inspected. This was to make sure that no bearings in the reduction gears had wiped, as you would find magnetic pieces of metal if they had. The lube oil purifier had to be taken apart and cleaned. The purifier separated debris out of the oil by spinning it, and this gave it the secondary purpose of also acting like a pump to pressurize the lube oil system. The lube oil purifier had something like 40 aluminum cones that were all stacked on top of each other that all had to come out one at a time and be cleaned individually, so that job alone took around an hour to complete. Oil samples also had to be taken in jars from any steam run pumps and the reduction gears. These samples would later be taken the next day to be checked for water contamination. Next, also standing watch in lower level, was the feed pump operator. He watched over the three big feed pumps, the steam-driven pumps that pushed water up into the steam generators. This watchstander was a senior guy, and since the pumps were an automatic for the most part, feed pump operator served as a supervisor in charge of lower level watch. This was my favorite watch. I got to use my extensive knowledge of the lower level systems, but didn't have to do all the pain in the ass menial labor. The watch station wasn't a free ride, though. The feed pumps were controlled by an air system called Hagen, which was unreliable. If Hagen suddenly went on the fritz, the feed pump operator had to recognize the signs and take manual control. If pressure was lost to the steam generators and level dropped too low in them, the reactors automatically scrammed to protect the plant. So, as feed pump operator, if you didn't know what you were doing or failed to act, you could be personally responsible for dumping the reactors and shutting down the plant. Not a place that you want to be. Finally, the lowest man, or lady, on the totem pole was the shaft alley watch. This was our most junior watch, and the only one allowed to leave the plant. This made them the runner for sodas, watch relief, and 100 other little things. Their primary duties were to trek aft to the shaft alleys once every hour to check for fire, flooding, or unauthorized personnel. They also had to inspect the main bearings. Just a day before we were supposed to transit the Suez Canal in 2004, the three-plant shaft alley didn't feel like making the trip down all those stairs and had been blazing his logs in for several hours. Unfortunately, the previous shaft alley patrol had accidentally left the drain valve open on the main bearing after inspecting it, and lube oil was pouring out of the bearing into the bilge. It actually wouldn't have been a big deal if his relief had done his job properly. It would have been found within the hour, and although there would have been a mess to clean up and oil to be replaced in the bearing, it wouldn't have been a problem. Instead, the bearing overheated as it went dry and destroyed itself, bringing down three plant. Now, you can't go through the canal with any shafts down, so every mechanic in three plant spent 24 torturous hours straight in three stern replacing that damn bearing so that we could get through the Suez and get home. The shaft alley patrol, who wasn't making his rounds, went to captain's mast for blazing logs and for the damage caused. The previous shaft alley that had left the valve open was not punished, and if anything, it saved his ass because it proved that he had actually been going down there on the previous watch. Hook is down and locked. There's the ship on our radar, 2 miles out, and we're doing about 300 knots. Right over the top, just a much, much better looking model than the old one. Very pleased with my purchase in this case. Beginning level break to the left, we'll keep it around 800-ish feet. Real Navy pilots, of course, striving to be extremely precise and even being graded on not only their landings, but also this entire approach and pattern work, always being observed and being assigned grades. And we're abeam of the touchdown area. There we go. Full flaps. I was still going a little fast, so they weren't coming down all the way. We're a mile astern of the ship, coming around onto final to line up with that landing area. Approach is looking good so far. 160 knots as we roll out on final. Less than a mile from the ship. Ramrod 1 has the ball. Now. I can see the arresting gear coming into view. see the big E painted on the back of the superstructure. And coming down right on target. Booyah! Looked like that might have been wire 3 for a perfect touchdown on board our new Enterprise. Radar is off. Start folding up this aircraft. And with the new superstructure in the background, let's taxi on out of this landing area to make room for those A4s returning from their mission, and maybe our number 2, wherever he may be. Then we'll park it right here near this tow truck, I think. There we go, that'll do. Alright, great mission this time out. I'm going to shut down this plane and we'll see you down in the debriefing to talk about the details of it. Okay, welcome to the debriefing. Little bit of a surprise here that I'll jump right to. It's telling me that the campaign is finished. This was our final mission for the A6 intruder. I thought we were going to make it out to 15, but I guess I did a little bit of math wrong, or maybe there was some wiggle room. So we went through the allotted time for this campaign, and now it's over. So this was our last one, and really, for being our last mission, it was a great one to go out on. So let's take a look at what happened here. So we were to strike a strategic target in the power plant to destroy that generator building, which we did with a vengeance. I had 4 direct hits, really making up for my dismal performance last mission. So embarrassing. Well, made it up to everybody this time with 4 great hits right into the target. Flight time was 41 minutes and 22 seconds. Primary target was destroyed. 1A6 was damaged. We saw that. That was Ramrod 2. He received pretty heavy damage. Left wing, vertical stabilizer. Outstanding success for us with a score of 2470. Lieutenant Commander Horner is awarded the Distinguished Flying Cross. Order has been received to halt all air operations. This campaign is finished. Now, obviously, there is not an actual halt to air operations. That's just what it says. When you reach the end of the campaign, we'll continue picking up right away with the next one for our next segment of Operation Rolling Thunder. Okay, looking at the stats for today, I fired all 4 of my AGM-62 Walleyes for 3 hits and 2 kills. It looked like they were all tracking on target. What I suspect happened is by the time the 4th bomb arrived, the target was probably destroyed and had nothing to hit, so I think that's why it's giving me that. But either way, I got 2 kills with them, which is good, and then we dropped the 2,000-pound bomb, which obliterated that S-60 for 1 kill. Lieutenant Commander McDonald fired 26 bombs and only hit 1 thing for that 1 kill up in Hanoi. He fired everything else at that Fansong radar that I really, really wanted to destroy, and he just missed. Very strange that he would be so off target with those bombs. But whatever, that's what happened. Maybe he was already damaged by then, and they were not able to drop their bombs properly. I suppose that is a possibility. Not to take too much time with the log, but I am a little curious just to see what I hit. You can see that I fired the 4 Walleyes at the generator building. The whole world was shooting at me. And then I hit the generator building with 2 Walleyes, destroyed the generator building, hit another building with the 3rd Walleye, destroyed it, and then the 4th one landed and had no other targets to destroy. So I got generator building and another building. So that's all I wanted to see there. I just wanted to see what that second target that I hit was. Finally, moving on to the roster. That was my 49th combat mission. I have my 13 air-to-air kills from the stint with VF-211, and I have 116 ground kills. Pretty outstanding work with the air-to-ground. We'll be going back to fighters soon, so we'll get some more air-to-air combat going. Michael McDonald, that was his 6th mission only. He only has 5 air-to-ground kills with that 1 extra today. Could have been more. Could have done a better job, but too late now because campaign is over. And speaking of that, this is our final look at the squadron roster for the duration of this campaign, doing an actually a pretty good job. We only lost two guys for the amount of danger over the capital region, which has been the primary focus of all of our missions. We've been going up to Hanoi or Haiphong for the majority of these runs, and we've only lost two pilots. We flew aircraft 300 for the entire duration, only receiving minor damage. It was able to be fixed every time, so we never lost our primary aircraft. So overall, this was a good campaign, and we'll be moving on now to a new campaign with a new squadron. Before we go, let's take a look at the Distinguished Flying Cross that I've been awarded, and we'll read that citation real quick. And here it is. President of the United States takes pride in presenting Distinguished Flying Cross to Lieutenant Commander Devin Horner for heroism and extraordinary achievement as an A6 intruder pilot. So good for me, I've received another award reflecting great credit upon myself and the United States Navy. I hope you enjoyed this stint with the A6 intruders. I know that there's a lot of ground combat that I've been doing, but at least in the Navy, so many of the aircraft are ground pounders. There's only two fighters in the Navy arsenal, and that's the F-8 and the F-4. So as much as I've been sort of avoiding it, the F-4 will be coming. We'll get to try that out. I would maybe like to go back to the F-8 again, since that campaign was cut short by getting shot down. So that may come about, but nothing is really definite yet. So come on back for more episodes and see where the story takes us. Thank you very much for watching, and we'll see you again in the future.